Jnana Yoga is supposed to be a very difficult subject. And we are discussing in the night after a whole day's activity. Making it much more difficult. Hopefully, I can make it easy. Essentially, we know what is yoga, chitta vritti nirodha, making the mind peaceful, quietitude. In other words, when the mind becomes peaceful, that you can go beyond the mind. Like the way, when the waves become quiet, then your perception goes deep into the ocean. The waves are created by the ocean, but the very waves prevent you from going into the depth of the ocean. The same way my own knowledge might prevent me from going deeper. So my mind is so agitated, mind itself is there because of the consciousness, because of the self. But then the agitations of the mind is so much that it prevents you from going deeper than that. So that is the reason why we need to have a technique or a trick, methodology to see that how I can transcend the mind. Manomayam atmanam upasankaramati. I cross the hurdle called manasu and then go beyond. When we go beyond that, then we become Anando Brahmeti Vyajanat, Anandadheva Khalu Imani Bhutani Jayante, our nature, the blissful state. A simple experience that we have also, that whenever we are really troubled at the mind level, you see that, how I wish I could have peace of mind. All these disturbances, I should cross over that, so that I become peaceful. That's a very simple idea. And yoga is a conscious process of going into that state. And in the problem is that just by asking, it does not become quiet. If somebody would have said that, come on, you keep your mind quiet. And if the mind really becomes quiet, we don't require any technique. Such people are called as the Uttama Sadhakas. That means to say they're extraordinary people. Shravanameva Alam. A simple suggestion is good enough for them to go beyond. But our minds are not like that, agitated, disturbed. So that's why we are not Uttama Sadhakas, we are Manda Madhyama Sadhakas, we are in between. We need certain methodology to see that how we can cross. And for that, we have this wonderful instrument called as the body-mind complex. You can use this instrument to go to the deeper states of consciousness or the state of consciousness, de-identifying that. That's what are the various techniques that are given. We can make use of prana to go beyond. We can make use of the techniques of meditation at the mind level to go beyond. That's what is meditation, dhyana techniques. Pranayama techniques will help you to go beyond prana. We use the physical postures and activities to see that how we can transcend. Like that, there are various techniques that are there. And we can also use the workplace, whatever the work that we are doing, by transforming the attitude behind the work, we can go beyond karma yoga. When we can use all these instruments to go to that peaceful state of mind, tranquil state of mind, a state which is beyond, with various support of various instruments. We have another wonderful instrument called intellect. Can we make use of this intellect to go beyond to intellect itself? Mind becomes silent. That's what is Jnana Yoga. Because intellect, the Jnana is the knowledge, and the knowledge, basically the forte of knowledge is your intellect. And your intellect can be used to go beyond body, mind, intellect, etc., and become one with the consciousness. That's what is the idea of Jnana Yoga. Now, This is something that is, we all have it. Intellect is something we all have it. The simple reason to show that we have the intellect is questioning. The moment that the child develops questioning, that means the intellect is blossoming. And the child starts questioning. Usually 3, 4, 5 year old child starts questioning. Anything that you tell the child immediately questions. Go and take shower. Why? We have to go for shopping. Why? There is no milk in the house, Baba. Why? Now mother gets irritated, shouts at the child saying that, stop all this nonsense, go and take shower. Child wonders why mom is angry with me, upset with me. Because I am just questioning. See, child develops intellect and starts questioning. The nature of the intellect blossoming is the process of questioning. Like the way, when you develop the strength in the legs, start walking. The child does not have any reason why she child walks. Gets up from here, walks, and then comes back. Falls. Mother says, why did you go? It's an absurd question. I have legs, so I go. That's a very simple answer. The child wants to question because the intellect is developed. For the child, questioning is important. But the mother has taken the question seriously. That's why she is worried about. She tries to give an accurate answer. Because you take the question seriously, you give accurate answer, that's where you are in the problem. You try to give any answer, that's okay. Go and take shower. Why? Because sun rises in the east. It has no connection. But it's okay. For the child, it is okay. One of the Sankranti festival days, there was a TV show, a quiz show for the kids below 7 years or 6 years, something like that. I was really excited to watch that quiz show for two reasons. One is a curiosity, how these kids are going to answer these questions. And second important reason is, at least in that quiz I can win. Normal quiz anyway I don't win. So I was watching and then some celebrities were there, Shah Rukh Khan and Amitabh Bachchan and all that. And then anchor lady, she showed a panel of children, pictures, select any child, no criteria, you can just, every child looks so cute. So anyway, one child was selected. And then this anchor showed a video clipping with that child, taking the child to aquarium, showing the fish there, and the fish coming closer and then moving together. And then when they come close, you know, move their lips and all that. She stopped that clipping after about a minute or so, couple of minutes. Then she asked the celebrity, if this child is asked the question, whether fish talk in the water or not, what will be the child's answer? And the celebrity scratched his head and remembered about all that what he has seen. Fish coming closer and moving the lips and all that. And then he replied to that audience, yes, the child says fish talk in the water. And then the lady continued with that clipping. She showed another pond where the are there, aquarium where the fish are there. Afterwards she asked that kid, beta, do the fish talk in the water? The kid's answer is instantaneous. He said, no, they don't talk in the water because they don't have hands. Hands has nothing to do with talking. For the kid, questioning is important, but you take questions seriously. Don't take questions seriously. Take the questioning seriously. You can have a fun with the kids. So questioning is developed because the intellect is developed. And because of the questioning, we develop the knowledge. And that knowledge is supposed to be jnana. Ajnana is something, nothing wrong. Because even though we developed jnana of several things, we also have a lot of ajnana. I might know about something, but I might not know about 1,000 other things. People feel bad about ajnana. Never feel bad because that's what is the starting point. Yes, I don't know. It's so simple to say, but we always feel ashamed that we don't know. That's a starting point. Even a person who is highly intellectual like Einstein, somebody asked him that, you know, you are a great master, you know so much about physics. He said, took him to the beach and picked up a grain of sand and said, the knowledge is like this whole sand here, and what I know is this grain. That much. So knowledge is something which is constantly going on. In fact, it happens. You didn't know about Prashanti, you came here, started knowing about Prashanti. First day when you came to Prashanti, they say, come on, where do you find Raghuram? Go to Vasishta. Where is Vasishta? But now you know where to come. See, a knowledge comes. But what is Jnana Yoga? A knowledge which gives you yoga, peace of mind, that's what is Jnana Yoga. Put these two things together. Yoga means peace of mind. Jnana means knowledge. A Jnana which gives you peace of mind is Jnana Yoga. Every other Jnana is Jnana, knowledge. Every other knowledge is knowledge. But a knowledge which gives you peace of mind is supposed to be Jnana Yoga. How can knowledge give peace of mind? Because our simple experience shows that knowledge takes away your peace of mind. So hard. You know, if the child is intelligent, parents will have a headache. The way that he questioned, they can't answer. If the students are intelligent, the teacher will have problem, you know. It's like he becomes nervous going to the classroom. How can knowledge give you peace of mind? Why all these things? Husband knows cooking, wife will have problem. Anything that you make, he finds out fault with that. Can it not be like this? Irritating. Any knowledge for that matter is a headache. Like I go to the Bangalore, it's a place of music concerts and all that. I go to the music concert. I love music. I go and sit down there. I absolutely have no sense of music. I go and sit down there. I keep enjoying the music. And somebody comes and sits next to me. And the moment he sits, first thing is he starts putting this, my God, this fellow is an expert in music. And then 15 minutes, this fellow spoiled the whole music. I don't know what he spoiled. He says, did you not see? Antaragandhara. He missed it. I mean, I don't know what is that Antaragandhara, where is it, what, and all that. I feel blessed that I'm ignorant. And knowledge takes away your peace of mind. How can knowledge give you peace of mind? This is where basically Jnana Yoga is very important, that we understand deeply. That's why it is necessary. Often people say Jnana Yoga means you should know about Sanskrit, you should have read the Upanishads, Brahma Sutra, and the Nitya Viveka, and then Jagan Mithya, Brahma Satyam, and then all these things. It looks like a headache for us. And how can we apply that in the day-to-day life? Because I have my problems, and you say Jagan Mithya, Brahma Satyam, how does it help me? And your Upanishadic knowledge and quotations from the Upanishad, how does it help me in the day-to-day life? How to translate all these things in such a way that I can apply in the day-to-day life? My problem is here, in the daily life. That's why it is not just all that knowledge. I'm not saying that that's unimportant. But we need to translate all those things into the daily life experience. Then only Jnana Yoga makes a sense. What I'm going to tell may be very simple things. It looks very simple. But the truths behind that is what the Upanishads give. The first and foremost thing is that knowledge is something that you acquire by questioning. Now, what is the importance of Jnana Yoga or the Upanishadic inquiring about the knowledge? One thing is that Upanishad inquires, taking the inquiry to the subtler, deeper level, does not stop halfway. It makes it the fundamental questioning. Normal questioning, it might look normal for everybody, but Upanishads take it to the fundamental level, fundamental questioning. What is it like? Let me give a simple glimpse of it. One thing, very simple idea, is that we are all seeking happiness. This is something, because it is happy there. Outside, it is cold, it cannot have happiness. He comes inside and settles down. Even a dog seeks happiness. Not only that, a plant, sun rises on this side, plant turns his flower on that side and takes the flower essence from the sun's essence from the flower, happy. The plant, you can see the happiness in the plant. So happiness is something which is there in every living creature. Human being also seeks happiness. And that's what Upanishad says very simply, sukhameva labdha karoti, nasukham labdha na karoti. It's a very simple statement. You don't really require big knowledge of Sanskrit to understand this. If there is happiness, you go for that. There is no happiness, you don't go for that. It's a simple law. We all know that. In fact, we all do that. In fact, there is happiness, then we go for that. There is no happiness, we don't go for that. Have you seen the latest Shah Rukh Khan movie? No, I've not seen. Have you seen it? Yeah, I've seen it. How is it? Boring. Then why do you ask me to go? You know, it's a very simple thing. If it is nice, I will go. Otherwise, don't go. If it's a nice music, I listen to it. Otherwise, I shut off the music. That's a very simple thing. Anything is like that. If there is happiness, I take it. No happiness, I don't go for it. I go to the restaurant. I'm hungry. I would enjoy my food. I go to the restaurant and ask that fellow waiter to bring the menu card. And these days, it's not menu card, it is menu book. And the number of items that are there in the menu book is like telephone directory. You have to go through the whole thing. That itself is a big headache. And you want to find a shortcut. After all, you are an IIT graduate, you know. Brilliant guy. So you call the waiter and that fellow comes. You want to enjoy food. So that's why you ask, what is fresh here? He says, everything is fresh. He's also smart. You don't want to get caught in that. So that's why, next question. Tell me, which is the best out of these dishes? Everything is the best. But you don't want to give up. You don't want to lose the battle. You still want to bat. So you ask the next question. Okay, if you are really hungry and you come here, you are not going to order the whole item of the menu card. So you would choose one item out of these. So which one do you choose? You cannot catch him now. Now that fellow also looks around. Nobody is nearby. And then he tells in your ear, if I'm really hungry, I go to the next restaurant. Not even. What do you do now? Sukhameva labdha karoti, nasukam labdha na karoti. And this is what the whole world does. In fact, socialistic philosophers try to give you happiness. Karl Marx has written Das Kapital, where the very preamble he writes, this is essentially to maximize happiness, maximum happiness to maximum number of people. Equity distribution, this, that, and all those things he has given. And then people try to implement that. And then we have seen 50, 60 years we experimented, struggled with that, and then found out it does not give up work. So they threw away. When Russia threw away, immediately capitalists came, materialists came and said, okay, we will give you happiness. We'll give you happiness, and we try to bring in democracy and the happiness and this and that. We have seen how democracies are working in the, all over the world. But anyway, capitalist, that means to say material gives you happiness. And that's what we have been trying. And if you want to know how the material gives happiness, you look at the advertisements. Every advertisement is essentially to give you happiness. An ordinary lady comes with ordinary soap powder and then empties that soap powder in a bucket of water, takes the dirty cloth and then she does, and then takes out the cloth, dirty. A smart lady comes, takes out surf excel, empties in a bucket of water, takes the dirty cloth, just dips it and takes it out. Wow! Happy. And then you also immediately go to the shop, get the surf excel, same color bucket. And then you also empty the soap powder in that bucket of water, and then you also put the cloth and take it out. You are unfortunate. After all, that fellow tried to give you happiness. If you did not get, what can we do? Material world is also trying to give happiness. So actually, socialistic society also tried to give you happiness. Material world also is trying to give you happiness. In what way Upanishads are different? Indian philosophy is different. In what way Jnana Yoga is different? Jnana Yoga is different in this next turn in the question. This is what I said. The question seemed to be an ordinary question, but the Upanishad takes a fundamental turn to the fundamental level. What is that fundamental level? Upanishad asks the question, don't look at what gives you happiness, what system gives you happiness, what object gives you happiness. Look at what is the nature called happiness, what is the experience called happiness. Sukham eva vijignasitavyam iti. You need to understand what happiness is. How this question is different? The question is different this way. What gives you happiness may not give me happiness. If you come out with an idea that such and such a thing will give you happiness, it doesn't give me happiness. It depends upon your upbringing, your various things and all that. In fact, it brings misery. What gives you happiness might bring me misery. But then, your happiness, I can understand. Happiness is common to all of us. But the object giving us happiness is not consistent with all of us. I love wonderful music, but somebody else might not like that music. However close the person may be. Like I love Hindustani classical music and I play early morning nice wonderful Hindustani classical music. But my teenage son comes up and says, Papa, how long do we have this morning music? Can we have something better? See, it doesn't give him happiness. And he plays his music. I look around some rattling sound. He said, no, that's my music. See? What gives me happiness does not. That means it is not consistent. Not only with two individuals, it's not consistent with you also. You don't even have to go around outside. For you alone, the same thing may not be consistently giving you happiness. Today you say it gives me happiness. Tomorrow it might not give you happiness. Why tomorrow? Next moment it might not give you happiness. Is it not your experience? Like you go to the sari shop and then you see the nice wonderful sari and say, wow, this is for me. I knew that I came here. This is all. And then you like that and nothing else. And all those things. And by the time you come to the counter and the fellow standing there said, can I replace this sari? You know, you are already not sure whether you would like to want that sari or not. You are not consistent with that. So that's why happiness object is not consistent, but experience is consistent. Not only that, what gives you happiness comes with such a huge lot of small print, they say. You know, so many clauses, so many ideas behind it. You do 1, 2, 3, 4, all that. By the time that you do that, you are really tired. You say, Mahapa, at least this is finished. You come to that conclusion. So that means to say, inquiry about what gives you happiness is not consistent. That's why Upanishad says, look at what is the experience called happiness. Why? Because that experience called happiness is consistent whether you are poor or whether you are rich, whether you are young or whether you are old, whether you are educated or uneducated. It's all the same. Everybody has the same experience called happiness. Look at the experience called happiness. In order to understand what is happiness, you don't have to go into the world outside. Look into yourself. And the best example for that happiness is your sleep state. We all enjoy sleep. Everybody enjoys sleep. Nobody is there who doesn't enjoy sleep. Particularly the Maitri Milan, I see people enjoy sleep so much. Yeah, early morning when you wake up and do yogasana and all that, by the time you come to the Maitri Milan, particularly these days, after having breakfast also, drags you. I was really tired one day when I was doing my engineering class. So tired, I could not control myself. And that lecture also boring. So I just put my hand under my chin, just closed my eyes for a moment. Just one moment, I opened my eyes. That's all. I found that teacher has gone. Next teacher has come and he's also gone. Third teacher is there. Ah, happiness. What exactly is the state called happiness in the sleep? Dreamless sleep. If you look at it, if you are a scientist, you need to compare the two states and find out what is the cause for that happiness in the sleep. Because we all enjoy sleep. What is that single cause for the sake of happiness? If you look at it, one minute before you fall asleep, 1 minute after you fall asleep, compare these two states. Before you fall asleep, your respiration is going on, your circulation is going on, digestion process, if any little, it's going on, blood is going through, all that things happening, and after you fall asleep, circulation is going on, heart is still beating, thank God, respiration is going on. It looks like the activity is the same in both wakeful state and sleep state. They're exactly the same, identical. Non-activity, if you take, you have switched off the light, you're lying down on the bed, sounds are not there, eyes are closed, everything is quiet, non-activity. And you fall asleep, lights are switched off, you're lying down covering yourself, no sounds are there. Non-activity seem to be exactly the same before you sleep, after you sleep. That means they score out. Before you sleep and after you sleep, states are identical. But then, your experience wise, the states are not identical. In fact, you lie down to wait for sleep to come. In the next 5-10 minutes, sleep does not happen. You start worrying, oh my God, am I suffering from insomnia? And then anything happens that it takes away that sleep. Why sleep is so important? If you look at it, there is one thing that makes the sleep so important. Mind is becoming quiet. Before you fall asleep, a thinking is going on, particularly for a housewife. What is that I have to do tomorrow for the breakfast? My God, you know, that's a big question, unsolvable question. This child doesn't like that, that child likes this. And if you do not do this and that, husband will look at you. How to escape from all these things? Everybody has his problem. But the moment that you fall asleep, mind has become quiet. This is what Brahdaranyak Upanishad puts it so beautifully. Tatra mata amata bhavati, pita apita bhavati, steno vasteno bhavati, etc. etc. Mother is no more a mother in the sleep state. I mean, what do you mean by that? Mother is still a mother in the sleep state? That's not the idea. Mother's worries, anxieties, responsibilities, they drop off the moment she goes to sleep. Mind not being active is the state of peace inside. That's what is the bliss inside. Pita apita bhavati. The father is no more a father the moment he goes to sleep. Does not mean that nothing happened, but only thing is, all the worries, anxieties the father has just drops off the moment you go to sleep. Esosya paramanandaha. What a beautiful way Upanishad puts it. This is what is your parama anandaha, blissful state experience, mind becoming quiet. Happiness is your own nature inside. Not only that, esosya parama samvit. If you go to sleep, before you fall asleep, you look at what is happening with you. Absolutely, you are tired, no more energy. You almost like drag yourself. Particularly the dishes, when you do it, you finish up. Finish the last dish and turn around, see a couple of coffee cups are sitting there. My God, you curse yourself. Everybody, Like these days, the last little work that we do before going to bed is the evil mail, called email, you know. You open the inbox, that there are 20 mails sitting there, you need to answer that. And last mail, you click shut down and all that, that I do it. And then I go to the bed, my wife says, did you check the front door? Where is the energy? I replied her many times, I'll check up tomorrow morning, not now. Night before you go to bed, you don't have any more energy. But look at what happens next morning when you get up. You have so much of energy, you can go for a 5-mile jog. You can go for a 2 hours of yoga class. Where is that energy coming from? Is it not coming from that mind becoming peaceful state? Not only you are blissful, but your energy is there in that. Your power is there, your strength is there in that. Esosya paramasambhitam. So that's all your nature. Peace of mind is your nature. Happiness is your nature. Then why are we running around for the happiness outside in the world? We have a wrong notion that the objective world gives me happiness. Once you know this truth, your nature is happiness, then you don't run around for the objective world outside for the sake of happiness. Life becomes so simple. In fact, a lot of our disturbances of the mind happens because that we are running after the happiness. We are like in the rat race in the world. That fellow has a bigger car, I must have a bigger car. This fellow has a bigger house, I must have a bigger house. You see, look at that fellow, he has all those things, I should have it. See, this is what is the running that we are doing. And we are amassing the wealth for that reason, and we are destroying the natural resources. How much of natural resources that we are burning? In fact, when I stay in Prashanti, I feel a couple of pairs of dress is good enough for me. I don't require anything more than that. Imelda Marcos has 6,000 pairs of shoes. When I was just thinking, even centipede will have 100 shoes. Why do we need so much of material? Because we have not understood. And for that material, how much of running around that we are doing? For what purpose? Why don't we stop this? Nature will be blessed if you understand this truth. Your peace of mind will be your own. You don't have to worry about. Recognize this. That can bring about a big revolution in the whole world. Because today the way that the world is going after the material comfort, we are destroying all the forests, we are destroying all the natural resources. Can we conserve that? Well, I understand my nature is happiness. Ah, well, what you said is fine. I can understand. Yeah, many times, honestly speaking, I was happy by myself. Yeah, truly I was happy. But you know what? I was really happy. I know, honestly, I don't know whether you believe or not, I was very happy. But then, you know, I got married. The problem started. Mullah Nasiruddin comes to the psychiatrist, and psychiatrist says, since when you have this problem? Says, since last 20 years. Tell me what really happened 20 years back, any incident? Said, I got married. Finished. Now, what is the problem? I like this. She doesn't like that. I want yellow curtains. She wants blue curtains. See? She also has the same complaint. What is this? I don't know. He doesn't even have a taste. What a nonsense. Is that way that it is? See, that means I like something he doesn't like. So, but then, now this is where Vedanta puts a question saying that, all right, you like something and she doesn't like, or you like something and he doesn't like. But what is the greatness about your liking? Can you reason it out? Why this should be something which is important? It's important because I like it. Is that the only answer? It's not a logical answer. Find out, tell me why it is good. Why do you say blue is good? You know, blue is like sky. Alright, blue is like sky. So what? Take the question further. Don't stop halfway. He also says, yellow, beautiful. Why yellow is beautiful? We have no answer for that. It's your preference, that's all. But we have taken our preference to be absolute. That's what Upanishad says. Your own preferences are not absolute with you. You don't like your own preferences. Like, you know, those days, We were in the project area. Project areas are very meagerly provided with. For everything, we have to go to the nearby city. So I was bachelor those days, young engineer working there. I wanted to come to my city, the nearby city. It's about 2 hours bus drive. So I wanted to come there and buy a train ticket, Hubli. And then my friend recently married 6 months ago, his wife, she said, Raghu, I heard that you are going to the city. I said, yeah, I'm going to the city. You want something? I can get it for you. Yeah, I want something, but you know, I have to buy it for myself. I said, why hassle of coming to, you know, 2 hours up and 2 hours down and all that? You tell me what you want, I can bring it. No, no, you can't bring it. I want something. What you want, you know, tell me. I want to buy a sari. Tell me what is the range, and you know, I don't know anything about that, but tell me. I can bring it. No, 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 I have to select myself. Okay, a male escort will be there, I'll be with you, you can come. So we can go to the city and you can buy and come back. Simple. And then you buy the sari, I buy the train ticket, and then we both can come back. So she came with me. That was the first time and last time ever I went with somebody to buy a sari. You know how the sari shops? You go there, that fellow opens a sari, all the folds, stretches on the table. First one, second one, third one, 10th one, 15th. I said, my God, you seem to be emptying the whole shop. I said, madam, can you please ask him that, you know, some specification? Yeah, 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 what are the price range? And he gave the whole range and she asked something. Oh, that range, I have plenty of them. He went to one other lot, pulled out, and then started spreading all those things. Do you have prints? Oh, we have plenty of prints. Now he went to another lot. Now in the prints also, you know, I like flowers. Oh, flowers, I can show you plenty of flowers. Then he started spreading those for his. Too many flowers? Fewer flowers you want? She spread it. If I have seen in the real life, somebody who is yogi, patience, that's what is a shop fellow. On, and I said, madam, in the next half an hour, the last bus going to the project will be going. Once that bus leaves, we may have to hire a hotel room and stay here in the city. And tomorrow morning, by the time we go back home, your husband will be ready with the divorce papers. Select immediately. And then out of that whole lot, she pulled up one sari. Raghuram, how about this? Wow, that's the best sari. Actually, I was also thinking of the same sari. This is so nice, it's so wonderful. So she pulled out that sari. Because I was just waiting, when does this get over? Anyway, another half an hour, that negotiations. Then she packed the sari. And then we rushed to the bus stop. The last bus was ready to go and we hopped into that. Settled down in the bus. Huh. I thought the problem is over, but the beginning of the problem actually. After sitting there while bus was going, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, suddenly she was so serious. I said, my God, what happened to you? Why are you not talking? She said, I'm upset with you. I said, why? What did I do for you? I came with you and we bought the sari and all that thing and you are still upset. And I'll come tomorrow to buy my train ticket. That's a different issue. No, I'm upset with you because I heard that you are an artist. Yeah, I'm a little bit of an artist. And you know about the colors and all that. Yes, I have some idea. I know some combinations and all that. And this sari is so wonderful. No, no, no. You didn't help me to buy the right sari. No, this is a wonderful sari. You know, those flowers are so beautiful. The combination is so good. And you look very beautiful in this particular sari. No, I'm buying this sari for my mother-in-law. Even your mother-in-law looks beautiful. I don't know. No, the other sari, yellow flowers, that was much better than this sari. I don't know what is that yellow sari now. You see? This is what I said. Your own choices are not absolute. See, in the first place, why are we suffering? We have taken the choice to be absolute. That's why I have seen people, husband and wife, fighting to the divorce because he doesn't have a different, he has a different choice, I have a different choice. Choices are different and it goes to that level where you lose your health. But choices are not absolute. You see, taking what is not absolute, the choices, and what is absolute. Your nature called happiness is absolute. And that you gave up, is it not ignorance? We are all intellectuals. Is it not simple thing? Why did you give up an absolute called your nature called happiness for the sake of which is not absolute, which is called as choices? Aham Brahmasmi. I am Brahman. That means I am the blissful state. Never give up that. If I say in the Sanskrit word like Aham Brahmasmi, it's a huge, you know, Upanishadic word. And I say in this simple example, it is something which you can apply it in the day-to-day life. Choices are not absolute. The whole world has taken choices important. Choice is freedom. Indian philosophy said, real freedom is freedom from choices. I have no choice. Once I give up the choices, I'm happy. Anything is okay. Huh, we must have some little choice. I had a good friend of mine, All India Institute of Medical Science, AIMS, gold medalist. Must be brilliant. And a Sardarji. Anyway, we were colleagues in the central government department and we were working together, staying together and all that. And that fellow never went for any shopping. Monday I forced him, come on, let's go for shopping. I wanted to buy a few things. He came with me. I said, "Arey, bhai Sardarji, you want to buy something?" He said, "First of all, I don't buy anything." But he said, "Okay, I want to buy." I said, "Okay, tell me at least something you want to buy." "Raghu, tell me, is life good?" "Sunlight is a washing soap. Life buy is a bath soap. Don't compare these two things for different purposes." "Baba, you asked that question to me, it's okay. If you had asked anybody else, what would have happened? Tell me what you require that for, so that I tell you what is the soap that you need to buy." You cannot believe his answer. He said, "I want to wash my hair." I said, "Let's get out of here. Have choice, all right." You know, when we didn't have all these choices, life was so beautiful. Like, you know, 40, 50 years ago, all these different varieties of soaps were not there. There were only three soaps in the market, if you remember my childhood days. One soap, red, big, black, and then that fellow rubs and rubs and rubs, advertisement. And then he says, size is the same, that is the criteria. It's a labor class soap. And another cinema star comes. The very star, when you look at it, you start smelling that. Lux, not for us. The shop fellow looks at my face half a mile away. It takes out Rexona, keeps it for me. Finish. You see, where is the choice? Life is so beautiful. Today you go there to the shopping place, hundreds of soaps, and every soap smells wonderful. And by trying to select that soap, you smell so many soaps that you get a headache now. And then you buy a soap and come home, wife looks at you and says that, "Did you get this soap? Now where do you go now?" You see, freedom from the choices is important. Market is there with flooded with the things, but you don't unnecessarily have to get caught up into that. If you are wise enough, just have little choice, that's all. Give it up, fish. Don't unnecessarily get caught up in that. What is absolute is your peace of mind. Nothing else come in the way of your... Well, I can see that peaceful state is wonderful and then, yeah, I can agree for anything. But that fellow disturbs me. This fellow disturbs me. I was so peaceful, so happy, but this fellow disturbed me. He insulted me. I mean, this is something which I hear people say, you know, that fellow insulted me. He kicked me. Okay? Accidentally his feet touches you, that's all. No, he kicked me. Hey, Baba, you know, he did not kick you. Well, he is so negligent that he did not, and he did not even say sorry to me. You know, all these things. That means there is a cause, there is an effect. There is a reason for me to get upset. Karyakarana Baddha Yogo. In the material world, the important law is cause and effect connection. Material law has a connection of cause and effect. So there is a cause and there is an effect. You heat the milk and the milk boils. There is a cause and there is an effect. And then we take that for the psychological laws also, that somebody hit me, somebody kicked me, somebody's feet touches me, I am upset. This is where Jnana Yoga says, question the premises. Somebody said something, somebody did something, you got upset. Should you really get upset? Alright, accidentally his feet touches. Do you get upset? Yes. That means to say anybody's feet touches you, you get upset. Right. Let it be anybody's feet, I get upset. But you know, honestly speaking, look at your own experience. You go to somebody's house, small little kid is there in the house, very cute, and then you take the kid in your hand and the kid literally kicks you on your chest and you enjoy those kicks. In fact, you know, when you go to somebody's house and pick up the kid and the kid kicks you, the mother says to the kid, hey, 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 don't kick Raghuram, he's a great yoga teacher. You know what is your answer for that? Don't say anything to the child is God. See, the child consciously kicks you and the child has become God. And whereas somebody else's feet accidentally touches you, becomes worse than a dog. That means to say this law, cause and effect, does not apply. Physical laws, cause and effect, inviolable, unchangeable. They're always applicable. Like every apple falling from the tree falls on the ground. Apple falling on the ground, it is a gravitational law. It is fixed. You try 1,000 apples, 1,000 apples fall on the ground. Just because in India it falls on the ground, in America it doesn't fall onto the sky, it also falls on the ground. Because that's what is the gravitational law. Whereas psychological laws are not like that. Somebody says something, I'm upset. Do you really have to be upset when somebody says something? Yeah. Should I not get upset? No. There's no reason. There's no absolute connection. Why? Because many times if somebody says, keep on saying something, say, ah, this fellow is always like that. Forget about it. You only say that. Any of the psychological things that whatever the things happen, you are upset and you are not upset. Kartum akartum. Getting upset, not to get upset. Freedom is yours. Somebody near and dear dies. Oh God, you are upset. You are agitated. It's such a way that you can't even speak a word the first day. Why are you upset? Because somebody died. He is not there anymore. But then really, if you are upset because somebody is not there, what happens to you after 10 days, after 15 days, after 1 month? Slowly you recover. You are no more upset. The person has not come back, but have you not come out of that upset? Which shows that you are getting upset and that fellow not being there are not absolutely connected. Yes, your affection brings about that, but you recover. Not only that you recover, how the next door neighbor comes to you and consoles you. You know, that fellow is a very great person, he was extraordinary. But anyway, one day somebody or the other has to go, you know, take it easy. You know, be composed. Come on, come back, come to the life, you know. And we take that assistance of those words, which means basically, we accept this suggestion, you don't have to get upset. Is it not true? Is it not ever? So I showed you that there are several incidents, any incident that is there in the life seem to upset, but we have always a reason to come out of that, because mind has a peculiar freedom. Manaha kartum akartum anyatha kartum. Kartum means getting upset, akartum not getting upset. I can get upset, I don't have to get upset. And not only that, Upanishad puts one more clause there. Kartum makartum anyatha kartum samartam bhavati. You can take the other way around. If this way it does not work, don't get upset. Like I try to tell my boss in one way, boss gets upset, shouts at me. Oh, he shouted at me. No, let me not get upset. Can I put it this way so that he can accept it? Anyatha karto. And we adapt that. You tell the child, don't go there because it's dangerous. But the child still wants to go. Then you say, you know, police is standing there. Usually this police becomes a victim. That fellow will be nice fellow. But the police is there and the child does not go. See, is it not anyatha kartum? Are we not doing that? So this freedom we have got, why are you getting upset? Why don't you do the other way around? See, I give these day-to-day examples because that can relate to our daily life. When I was in the college days and then I went to my uncle's place, and that was a colony where the director was there and other people were there, and then I was a boy, kid, playing football. The director would love, because he was a Bengali director, Bengalis love football. He would stand there and watch me playing football. I was a good player. And then after the game is over, he would call me. Bengalis like two things. One is football and the other is fish. So he would take me, he would ask me to bring a bag from inside. I would ask auntie and she would give me a bag. We both go to the shop and he would buy fish. I would carry the bag. Asked me to give it inside, I give it inside, and then we used to play some table tennis and then come back. One day his wife said, hey, you take Raghuram every day, why don't you invite him for dinner? He said, hey Raghu, aaj shaam ko hamara ghar dinner aa jao. They wait, you know, after all bachelors waiting for dinner invitation. So by the time we finished the club and went home, he prepared the dining table ready. She prepared and then I sat down and then she started serving the fish. I said, no, I don't eat fish. Wow. When did you stop eating fish? I said, no, I never started eating fish. I never ate fish. In the lifetime you never ate fish? No. Why? You are a Brahmin. Then she said, we are also Brahmins. I said, look, Bengali Brahmins do a lot of things which we don't do it. Then she said, wow, but it's nice to know that you never ate fish, you don't know anything about fish, but you select every day such nice fish. Now I was shocked. I said, when did I select a fish? Then she turned to her husband. That fellow, very philosophical answer he gave. You know, it's all very simple. If I say I selected the fish, you always find fault with that. Take Raghu with me, he selected fish. Nice fish. Anyatha kartum. He can make several ways to bring about. Never give up, but never become unhappy. Find all the different ways, whatever that you can do it. These are all the different things that are. Mind has such an extraordinary freedom. You don't have to get caught up in the mind. You know, all our problems are, we get caught up in the mind. Angry, upset, disturbed, this, that, and all that. Now, if I don't get upset, how can the world change? You see, husband says something, well, don't show upset. If I don't get upset, he doesn't change. Boss is unnecessarily commenting. If I don't get upset, the boss will not change. Oh, you are getting upset so that the other person has to change? Then get upset. Vedanta doesn't hold anything tight. He says, come on, you also get upset. The only thing is, you show upset. Don't burn yourself. Become like a lighter. Don't become like a matchstick. You know, matchstick burns itself. Don't you burn yourself. You want to show upset? Show upset. Ramakrishna Paramahansa gives a way. You know, cobra he. Hisses and then people run away. It should not be like a bite. There's a small little story that Ramakrishna used to give, that is, a cobra used to come disturb the people, and then a saint came there in the village and then called that cobra, and he has a special way of communicating to the saint, to the cobra, said that don't hurt people. And then 6 months later, when the saint came, he found that cobra beaten and emaciated, no food to eat, and people were meddling with that. So naturally, the saint, by his special power, found out that how the cobra suffered. He said, look, I told you not to bite people, but I never told you not to hiss. Your anger should be like a hiss, not like a bite. But look at what happens. Our anger bites us. My BP goes up. My sleep gets disturbed. This is what happened. Don't get upset. Because don't give up anger. Because anger may be a wonderful correcting force. Anger is a wonderful correcting force. Jealousy is a correcting force. These are all the things which are necessary. By anger you can solve a problem. Maybe you cannot, without getting angry, you may not be able to solve for months together. One shout of an anger, maybe whole thing can be corrected. Anger is a wonderful force. That's why in the creation there is nothing like bad or good. How you use it? It's like fire. Fire itself is neither bad or good. You use the fire for cooking the food, it is good. But the fire to burn your house, it's bad. What you use for? Your anger also. You should not burn your house. It should cook your food. That's how you use anger. That's why in the Indian philosophy we have anger is like any other force. Yadevi sarvabhuteshu manyurupena samstita namastasye 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 namo namaha. Oh goddess, mother Durga, you are in the form of anger in everybody. My salutations to you. See how wonderful it is. Don't give up anger. It's a wonderful force. I mean, give up anger. Can you think of giving up anger? It's a wonderful spice of life. Just imagine, husband and wife are there, nobody is angry with nobody, life goes on like that. I mean, it is like, you know, every day eating khichdi. Absolutely spiceless, tasteless, nothing. I mean, you should be angry, you should be upset, and she also should be upset, and you shout and she shouts and all that. And it's a normal thing. And then voice rises, you know, when you are shouting angry, goes up, and finally he says, when he cannot rise further, he says, stop this shouting because you are heard in the next door. So, what is the next solution after all that shout? I don't talk to you, you don't talk to me. Silence. You know, naturally that's what happens. After the thunderstorm, everything becomes quiet. That's the nature. So you don't talk to him, he don't talk to you, and everything is quiet. Particularly when she's angry, she prepares nice, wonderful food. Spicy. He also eats well. And then settles down on the bed. Now there's a problem. Because tomorrow morning there is a head-going meeting in the office at 8 o'clock. He has to get up at 6 o'clock and rush to the office. And unless until she wakes up, he cannot wake up. See, all these complications. How to do that? How to manage that? But he is, after all, you know, a chief executive, so he has wonderful ideas. So he wrote a post-it note and kept it on the table. Please wake me up at 6 o'clock in the morning. And waiting, because she will bring the glass of milk for him. But she can also not talk, you know. She brings a glass of milk and then puts it there. Thump, make sound. Milk is there. And then he is watching through his cover. She noticed that what he has written. Ah, problem is solved. I communicated to her. He sleeps comfortably. Next morning gets up, looks at the watch, 7 o'clock. My God. And then he looks by the side. If she is sleeping, he could have excused her. He is large-hearted. But then she is already up and busy in the kitchen. My God, she is up and she did not wake me up. Nonsense. Angry, upset. But then, before shouting at her, he wanted to make sure that he wrote correctly. And he wrote correctly. Wake me up at 6 o'clock. But below that he noticed, she also wrote, please wake up, it is 6 o'clock. She also wrote on the post-it, what do you do? Enjoy. Nothing bars you from enjoying. Okay? You can enjoy anger, you can enjoy jealousy, you can enjoy anything. Provided only one thing, don't ever give up that your nature is happiness. The moment that you miss that, the spice of life is gone. Jnana Yoga says, Aham Brahmasmi, I am that Brahman. My nature is something like blissful state. Brahman, you know, Upanishad gives the definition of Brahman as Anando Brahma Kam Brahma Kam Brahmedi. It is Akasha Tattva, it is an expansiveness. I don't have any limits. Akasha, kham is akasha. And kham, that means to say, ananda. That's what is my nature. That's what is atma sthiti. Don't find atma anywhere outside. Atma is within you. And that's what is the blissful state. Recognizing this, understanding this, analyzing this is what is called as shravana. Ruminating it, working on this is what is called as shravana, followed by manana. And then you recognize, you know, there may be several incidents in your lifetime where you had unnecessarily got worked up on that. Today you can resolve all those things. It does not matter how long back it has happened, how many days back it has happened, how deep it has happened, you can resolve it. Once you do that, you are established yourself in that peaceful state. That's what is in Jnana. Like the way in Raja Yoga we have Dharana, Dhyana, Samadhi, in Jnana Yoga we have Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana, Abhyam. This is what is the idea. That's what is the way Jnana Yoga does. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to do Nadi Shuddhi Pranayama, Kapalbhati, etc. Just analyze yourself, correct yourself. The happiness is yours. You don't have to go out anywhere else. You are the master of yourself. Thank you so much.